Hello, everybody. Welcome to We're Better Than This, a virtual conversation on the late Congressman Elijah Cummings and his brand new political memoir. My name is Daryl Wilson, one of several hundred D.C. Public Library staff providing library service to Washington, D.C. residents. This program will be hosted by D.C. Public Library as we recognize the one-year passing of Congressman Cummings, the reopening of the Martin Luther King Jr. Memorial Library, and the book itself, available soon at dclibrary.org. This program is also in partnership with INKPEN, a local nonprofit that serves under-resourced schools and also provides opportunities for authors of color to interact with readers of color. So join me as we introduce the founder and executive director of INKPEN, Mrs. Darlene Taylor.
Thank you, Daryl. And thank you, DC Public Libraries. Today is the anniversary of the day that Congressman Elijah Cummings departed from us. But he left us with a message, his words in this book, and his legacy in Congress. He left us a call to do better and be better, to care for our communities and our democracy. And We're Better Than This, Elijah Cummings remind us of the importance of education. As his former chief of staff, I heard him speak to young people and policymakers on the power of mentoring and education. He often said, children are an investment in a future we will never see. And for INKPEN, that's a call for us to invest in our children and the futures of all readers through the gift of books. INKPEN started with a passion for reading and the memories of the books that inspired us. And as an alum of DC Public Schools and a proud holder of a Petworth Library card since I was a kid growing up in that neighborhood, that inspiration continues to live with me and in the people who serve on our board. Books inspire us at INKPEN. So we share books by writers of color with students in DC Public Schools. We do that through school libraries and through the librarians and in neighborhood libraries like Petworth and the Martin Luther King Jr. Library. We're delighted to partner with DC Public Libraries to bring Dr. Maya Rockeymoore Cummings and James Dale to the library for a conversation with Suzanne Malveaux, an award-winning journalist and CNN commentator. But importantly, Suzanne is also a neighbor here in the Washington community. Suzanne serves as CNN's national correspondent covering politics, national news, and international news and culture. For more than 10 years, she's covered the White House and has interviewed all five living presidents. She covered presidential campaigns and the retirement of Supreme Court Justice Sandra Day O'Connor. And also she traveled embedded with US troops in Afghanistan. She covered Congressman Cummings from his chairmanship of the Congressional Black Caucus to his chairmanship of the House Government Operations Committee. She also covered him those last celebrations of his life in October. And today she helps us remember him in a conversation with his wife and his partner in writing this book. Thank you, Suzanne.
Thank you, Darlene and INKPEN for inviting me to facilitate this important discussion. Thank you, Daryl and the DC Public Libraries and the Martin Luther King Jr. Library for hosting this incredibly special event. I'm so honored and pleased to be with my friend, Dr. Maya Rockeymoore Cummings, the widow of the late Congressman Elijah Cummings, and co-author James Dale, who worked with the Congressman to write and tell his amazing story. While I recognize that our time is limited, I do want to take a minute just to share my family's special relationship with both Maya and Elijah. Both Elijah and my dad were proud Howard University alums. They often traveled in the same circles of accomplished Howard graduates. My parents, Myrna and Floyd, would often enjoy seeing Elijah and Maya at many DC events, galas, and social gatherings. I think at the time they were going out and having more fun than I was. Elijah was also our congressman. Which not only included Baltimore, but also Ellicott City, Maryland, where my parents resided for many years. When my mother was diagnosed with ALS and we needed to cut through the maze of red tape to get Medicare and reimbursements, my sister Suzette reached out to our congressman, Elijah, who helped our family in our greatest time of need. Well, that meant the world to me and our family, and we are so very grateful. I also had the opportunity of getting to know Congressman Cummings, covering him as a correspondent for CNN, where I saw his passion and his fight firsthand. So thank you for this opportunity to talk about his living legacy today through his story revealed in his timely memoir, We're Better Than This, My Fight for the Future of Democracy. So Jim, thank you for joining us. I really appreciate it. First of all, just tell us how this collaboration began, how it came about. I understand there was even a period of courting between the two of you in early 2019 before you got started.
That's right. Well, it actually came about by way of Maya, who she and I happened to have a mutual acquaintance. And as things happened, they were talking and our mutual friends mentioned my name and what I did. And Maya said, I'd like to talk to him. Is this the kind of work he would do? And she said, the mutual friend said, well, you should talk and we'll see. And we spoke and we had a very good conversation. And she said, well, then you need to go meet Elijah and see if you two hit it off. And I went to his office and he had booked me for, I don't know, half hour, an hour. And about 3 hours later, we had spent a lot of time together. He had told me a lot of stories. He asked me a lot of questions about writing books, about the publishing process, about timing, about all sorts of things. And as I said later in an introduction to the book, I later realized that this questioning of his, this sort of attorney-like interrogation, so to speak, friendly interrogation, was very much like his style of learning and preparing as an attorney and preparing his case. And it was indicative of what we're going to go through. But it was a very, very cordial, very emotional meeting. Even this very first one, we didn't know each other at all. And we arranged for a second meeting. The second meeting Maya came to, we went through more stories and more conversation and more exploration. And I remember at one point I said to him, you know, doing a book like this is very time consuming. Sure. you have a pretty heavy schedule. You're in Baltimore and you're in DC, you're traveling, you're negotiating, you're signing subpoenas, you're going through, and this was right around the time that the Democrats had won the House back. So he was carrying an even greater onus at that time. And I said, do you have time to do this?
Sure.
As I said in the introduction, he said to me, Jim, I will make the time. I will make the time. And I later said that was an early clue of two things. One, every time he said your name, it meant what I'm about to tell you is important. If he preceded something, Jim. And also he repeated himself. I will make the time. I will make the time. It was, and I learned later the cadence of his speech was so important to the way he expressed himself. The child of preachers, he had a delivery and a cadence that was quite powerful.
And Jim, you talk about in the introduction, I think you called it Elijahisms, the fact that that's how he introduced himself in your very first meeting, telling you, calling out your name and making sure that you understood the importance of the project. Give us a sense of the process here. How was he able, as well as Maya, to gain your trust to the point where you say you almost had his voice, that you were able to write in a voice that it almost sounded like it was him talking?
Well, that is what I'm supposed to, that's what I try to do when I write these, when I write books. And I actually early in one of our early conversations, either the first or second one, the question was, okay, we've sort of had these two dates and we like each other and he's told me stories. He's opened up a good deal, much more than I thought, much earlier than I might've expected. But the question was, am I the guy? You know, that question arose and I said, well, you know, this is a chance you have as the writer to sell yourself. And I thought, well, I'm not going to do that. I said, you know, there's no shortage of people who could do this. And there's no shortage of people who would want to do this. This is a powerful, important story. But I said, I will offer you a piece of thought of advice. Regardless of who you select to work with, make sure you're comfortable, because you're going to share your life and you're going to, that person needs to capture your voice. So please make sure you're comfortable. And he said, I'm comfortable. Let's get started. I mean, there wasn't 2 seconds of air in there.
he didn't want to waste any time. He was in a hurry. He was in a hurry. And he started to open up about his health and about his relationships. What was behind that? What was it like to receive such intimate information about him in such a short period of time, the relationship that you had with him?
It was remarkable. And, you know, I would go to his office in Baltimore or in D.C. I rode back and forth with him in his car sometimes. We spoke on the phone all the time. We exchanged texts all the time. But he opened up quickly. But interestingly, sometimes I'd go to a topic and he'd say, well, I don't want to talk about that. And I learned very quickly to say, well, okay. But why don't we, he'd say to me, why do you want to know about that? And that his health was, of course, one area, because he had limited his activities. There was the story that was out there and was in fact true was that he had had this aortic valve replacement. Mm-hmm. He had had some trouble with mobility in terms of gout and infection in his knee. But it was clear that there was more to it, and we didn't know exactly what, and I didn't know where I was going, honestly. I just said, well, let's talk about your health. And I thought we were going to talk more about the heart condition and perhaps the emotional feeling of not being able to be mobile anymore for someone who was highly physically active.
Sure.
And I started to go there, and he said, well, I don't want to go there. So I said, well, why don't you talk about it? And after you listen to yourself, you can tell me if you want to include it or not. This is your book. I'm not an investigative journalist. I'm a person telling your story. So he talked to me that day for probably an hour and a half about his health. And he just opened up. And I learned some things I didn't know before about the extent of his challenges. And near the end of it, he said, I said, what do you think? And he said, let's tell it. It's the truth. And it was really a case of, you know, so when I talk about capturing his voice, in a way, he sort of injected his voice into me. So, you know, that kind of listening and absorbing and letting him talk as much as I'm talking right now, I shouldn't. Letting him talk was really the secret.
And Jim, he was a truth teller, and he reveals so much in this memoir. In the introduction, you write late in the evening on Wednesday, October 16th at 11:10 p.m., you texted him and you said, quote, Congressman, I'm working on a section leading up to and into impeachment process. Would like to talk when you have a few minutes. And then we know that he died at 2:45 a.m. on October 17th. That was just less than 4 hours after you had texted him. Did you have any sense, any idea that that would be your last correspondence, that it was so close to that point?
No, I knew he was, you know, that he was suffering more and not doing well. But, you know, and Maya will probably talk about this, if so many people around him sort of felt that he, including him, that he would have these terrible bouts and he would kind of claw his way back. And he wouldn't be 100% of what he was prior to that. But maybe he was going to make it back to 90% of what he was that month before, 2 months before. And I think there was always a feeling that he would make it, you know, he would come back a little diminished, but determined. And, you know, never diminished in terms of his voice or his attitude or his actions, but physically. And so I sent texts to him, and he sent texts to me at all hours. And sometimes it was an hour or two or three delay, but, you know, it could be that he finally went to sleep or he had another meeting or something, but he always responded. So I thought, well, I'll get an answer. either the next day, or my usual thing is I'd get one in the middle of the night when I was finally sleeping and he wasn't. Mm-hmm. So no, I did not. I thought it was a time of jeopardy, but I didn't think it was the end. And I woke up the next morning to my text screen filled with messages from all kinds of people who knew I was involved in the book saying, I'm so sorry. I can't believe what happened.
Jim, what did you learn from Elijah in the process of writing this book? How did it change you?
It's in many ways. And I've said I've written several books and I've never had it. And I've enjoyed them. I really have gotten to know some fascinating people. I've never had an experience move me as much, by far. And I would say that what I learned is about unbelievable persistence and determination. Remarkable optimism. And I don't mean happy talk optimism. Very serious, you know. I said to him many times of what the country's going through, do you feel we're going to get through this? And he would say, he took long pauses and say, yes, I do, but it's going to be very difficult. But I do believe so. I just think it's going to be much harder than we're used to. I learned a determination. I learned, he overcame things that I have not had to overcome. Sort of made me think sometimes some of the things I complained about were really kind of stupid, it gave me a sort of feeling also that you have to take the time you have and do as much as you can with it. When he said he was in a hurry, it was not only his illness, it was also his attitude in life.
And Jim, in this process, tell me what you understand to be really the main message or the purpose of this book that Elijah conveyed to you during your time together. What do you hope is that message that comes through to people who pick up this book and read it?
Well, that's an awfully good and a hard question. But I will tell you that I asked him that question at the very beginning. I don't know if he would have changed his answer later on, but I said, why do you want to write a book? You know, lots of people wake up one day and I think I'll write a book. And he said, I want to leave a message for young people, particularly disadvantaged young people. And he said at one point, and particularly men, he said, although men and women as well, particularly African-American young, but kept saying young people, to know what is possible. Not necessarily, I'm filling in the words here, not necessarily what's likely or probable, but what's possible. He said, because I, Elijah Cummings, I think I've accomplished some of what is possible, a good deal of what is possible. And I think that's a message he wanted. Now that's a very big, broad message, but you know, in the book, there's a story of when he was sworn in in Congress and his father was there. And he said he was looking at his hands and saying, the blood that runs through my hands runs through your hands, that, you know, in other circumstances, perhaps that could have been me. So that notion of possibility, I think, is what I think that's his legacy.
Well, Jim, thank you so much. It really is such an inspiring story. It is an incredible read. We appreciate your time today to talk about it and what that process was and what you learned from the congressman. And again, thank you.
All right. Well, I will say the last thing is, again, you're going to talk to Maya now. She made this possible. And she pushed him too, because he talked about doing a book. And then she said, well, come on, time to do the book. And I give her enormous credit for her own drive to make that happen. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Jim. Maya, congratulations. This is an absolutely amazing read. It took me right back to those epic battles that Elijah Cummings had with the president, the White House. His mission to hold them accountable also revealed many things that we really didn't even know about him. So tell us how the idea came about, the timing of this, that it was important to tell his story.
Well, you know, I've been on Elijah for about 8 years to write a book, you know, and I tried to help him out. I got my brother to try to help him out, but those efforts didn't work out. And then as Elijah, you know, ascended to the chairmanship of the House Oversight and Reform Committee, I really thought it was imperative for him to get his story out. And so I was just desperately looking around for someone to help him. And it just so happens I was having lunch with a friend and she turned me on to Jim Dale, and Jim worked out perfectly. So we're blessed.
Did you realize how limited amount of time you had when you started this journey writing this book?
No. So, you know, Elijah has been struggling with health issues for a very long time. And he battled them, you know, had bouts where things got serious, but he always seemed to bounce back. And so, you know, we didn't expect that when we started seriously on this book, that he would only have basically less than 2 years of life. The reality is that I do believe that the stresses that he underwent the last year and a half to 2 years of his life contributed to his early demise. And certainly the attacks from the president and other things that I'm sure we'll get into, you know, didn't help at all. That being said, Elijah always acted with a sense of urgency. He was so focused on time, and his words were always, use your time effectively and efficiently. Those were his two favorite words. And so every day for him was a day to be effective and efficient, to get things done. He often wanted to get things done for the people. And this book is his legacy to the American people, that he wanted to leave them a message from beyond the grave about what we're facing as a nation and what we must do to rise above it.
He was somebody who was a history maker as well. I mean, you knew him in such an intimate way as a partner and a husband and a soulmate. But seeing the opportunity to cover his memorial at the U.S. Capitol, the first African-American to lie in state, what was that like for you to even realize that he was also a history maker?
You know, I've always felt that way about Elijah. I believed in him. He inspired me as he inspired so many other people. You know, I've seen his leadership capacity throughout the years. And even when he doubted himself, I believed in that man. I mean, he showed and demonstrated his immense capacity for leadership when he became the chairman of the Congressional Black Caucus. And then, of course, when he rose to the chairman of the House Oversight and Reform Committee, I think it just affirmed what everybody knew about him. When he opened his mouth, people listened. When he said things, people stopped. When he, you know, said that something was going wrong, people really took note. And so with that, you know, my late husband was a man of great import. And I'm so glad that his colleagues saw fit to honor him with an opportunity to lie in state in the U.S. Capitol. I'm so sad that less than a year later, we would also see John Lewis, Elijah's mentor and friend, in the same situation. So, you know, with that, we've lost two great men. And with that, but I'm so glad that the nation recognized him.
And one of the examples in the book that you talk about is really his voice impacting folks was around April 2015, the Freddie Gray protests. And I was out there covering and they were mostly peaceful demonstrations before the unrest. And you tell this, he tells this beautiful story of how he went out onto the streets and he reached out to a young man, John, who had a gun and it was very angry and probably going to get into some trouble. Can you tell that story for us? Because it was so transformational for that young man.
Absolutely. So Elijah not just put his voice on the line when the Freddie Gray unrest happened, he put his body on the line. He went up to the intersection where the police were lined up and where the protesters were lined up, and he put his body in between the police and the protesters. He knew that the situation was a powder keg, and he wanted to do everything in his power to defuse the situation so that Baltimore would not be destroyed in the process. That being said, in one of the first nights, he ran into this young man, and the young man told him, "Look, Congressman, I wake up every day and I feel like I'm in a coffin, and I spend my day trying to claw my way out." And it was just profound. I mean, it just, Elijah came back telling that story and he told it over and over and over again. But Elijah came back to the brother and said, look, you know, don't you have a young family? You know, what would happen to you if you know, you pop off tonight and then you, you know, either go to jail or worse, you know, what would happen to that family? And the man was just angry, as many young Black men in Baltimore were and still are in many cases. And so Elijah's like, look, man, I care about you. And he hugged him and he told him that he loved him. And so a young man that night who was willing to just challenge the police because he was so frustrated and angry. And so the next day, Elijah went back around the same time, which was near curfew. And there was John leading the crowd, telling everyone that they should get home in time for curfew because he didn't want anybody to get harmed either. And so what you had was a situation where Elijah was able to use the power of persuasion, the power of his personality, the power of love, frankly, to basically turn someone who was very angry into someone who was willing to cooperate and who became a leader himself outside on that street corner.
And Maya, we saw so many examples time and time again, Elijah's love for Baltimore, that he lived in that house in West Baltimore for more than 30 years, and he wanted to be close to the people who represented him. Why was it so important, his city of Baltimore?
Elijah loved Baltimore like you would think about loving a person. This was a city who fed into him, that poured into him, where people just surrounded him with love, allowed him to propel himself to the heights that he reached in life. He can point to the streets where things happened, to the places where people said things and supported him in doing things, the institutions that were critical for his development. And he just believed very strongly in the city of Baltimore and loved it with all of his heart.
So when the president attacked the city of Baltimore, he called it disgusting, rat, rodent-infested mess. We see in the book Elijah's response. He says, he writes, this hurts, it hurts, it brings me pain so much I could be dead. And he goes on to say, it could kill me. He says, I've never known where the line is between body and soul, between head and heart, but I could feel the attack to my core. Why was it so personal, Maya?
Elijah was so empathetic. People just don't understand that he was a feeling man, someone who just felt deeply. And so, you know, he took that attack as if it were, you know, physical, and if it were, you know, the president being directly in the room with him. And I think also, if I were to speculate, that, you know, Elijah, of course, grew up, as I mentioned, in the Jim Crow South here in Baltimore early in his life. He knew what it was like to be dispossessed, to be not recognized as a fully human being, to not be considered a real citizen, to be marginalized within one's own country. And to have a president, a sitting president of the United States of America, treat Baltimore and the people of Baltimore and surrounding areas as if it was not a great American city, as if it didn't belong, it just took him back. It pained him. He felt it was visceral for him.
What would he advise young people to do who feel the same way that he had felt when they are attacked? What would he say to them?
He would say, mount a challenge. Just what people are doing out in those streets, Black Lives Matter, Elijah, and people like John Lewis once did. And just like they were fighting for an era in civil rights, we are still fighting for the next era of civil rights. And so everybody out there with Black Lives Matter, Black, Brown, Purple, you name it, he would have basically applauded them, saying that absolutely keep pressuring the system, because this is a system that is great, but you actually have to hold it accountable for it to work for everyone.
And that was so much a part of his mission. He talks as well about, he did something that some Black leaders were not able to do or do not do readily. And that is, he tied in the different groups, all the marginalized groups, together and linked them together in a way that you could relate, that everybody in some way from all these different groups has been bullied. He did not exclude anyone.
Elijah was an inclusive person. It didn't matter to him. He worked across party. He worked across all kinds of differences. And he was willing to learn, certainly as society evolved around, for example, LGBTQ issues, he evolved along with it. And he recognized that we all belong in we all have a common humanity, and we all should be respected according to the value of our common humanity and the dignity that we should all be afforded because of it. The differences, whether it's race, whether it's class, whether it's religion, whether it's sexuality, whether it's gender or whatever, he felt like that was a distraction. Where we need to bond is at the level of our common humanity, because that is what makes us great. He often said, our diversity is not our problem, it's our promise.
Do you think that people took advantage of him, of this gift that he gave them of goodwill or grace? The members, some of the Republicans who reached across the aisle, but gave him kind of a lukewarm, he said he felt a defense when the president attacked him, when he was working with some of his colleagues on these investigations, like the Benghazi investigation. And he said he realized it was a witch hunt. And yet time and time again, he was willing to give the grace and to work with those colleagues. Did it ever pain you, or did it ever concern you that perhaps they did take what he was giving for granted?
So Benghazi, I think, Trey Gowdy was the chairman at that time, and Elijah was able to, even after Benghazi, Elijah and Trey basically bonded, and Elijah, spoke to him personally, gave him advice about his career. I think that he considered Trey Gowdy, certainly an operative when the cameras were on, but when the cameras were off, they were just two guys talking about life. And Trey Gowdy decided to retire and go back to his home state. And that was after a conversation with Elijah about his frustration about the current political environment. But I do think that there are people like Mark Meadows, for example, the president's chief of staff, who I think have always had ulterior motives and who have positioned themselves for advancement. Even as they were presenting a face of friendship.
It's a tough read. It looks like he, time and time again, in this memoir, gives the grace and the understanding, the empathy that so many people need. And he dedicates a whole chapter, the first chapter of his initial meeting with President Trump back in January of 2017, the chapter called "The Lie and the Lesson." The first Democrat to privately meet with Trump. And if I could just read this passage, the conclusion, he says, is he had faith. Even people who fundamentally disagreed could accomplish good things. I still believe that, but I don't believe it's possible with this man, this president. Is he saying that Trump was just not redeemable?
Yes. I think that Elijah was just very convinced in the end. He was willing to give Donald Trump the benefit of the doubt. He crossed, party lines. When we went to that, inauguration of Donald Trump, he did it despite the fact that the Democrats had a high profile boycott led by John Lewis of the inauguration.
How difficult was that?
It was difficult. He pondered, we talked, we debated. And ultimately, he went to John Lewis and asked for special dispensation to attend. And John Lewis said he understood. And so we attended. And so with that, Elijah really took the measure of the man. And at the end of the day, he firmly believed that Donald Trump was corrupt inside and out, that his soul has been corrupted. And that it is not possible for this man to actually be loving, to be kind, to be open, or to be empathetic.
One of the things that Elijah did do is that he made a number of very strong, powerful cases as the chair of the Government Oversight and Reform Committee. I covered the hearing when he talked about the immigration policy separating children from their parents. And I'll never just forget that message, the booming voice saying, come on, man, we're better than this. Well, what was behind this moral charge that we kept seeing over and over again at these oversight hearings?
What was behind it was Elijah's own experience with life. Again, being born into the Jim Crow South, but seeing firsthand, up close and personal, that when you challenge a system, when you participate in an integration march at 11 years old, you get to swim in a great Olympic-sized pool. And that lesson is a larger lesson in life. When people challenge the system, whether they're African Americans or women, or very diverse groups of folks, that you can actually get what you need from the system. And so time and again, we've seen America presented with all kinds of challenges where people who have been initially biased, have been swayed by the arguments, by the sheer presence of many people who have been affected. And he's seen the country change. He's seen a transformative difference in how the country operates. And he said, if we can do that before, we can do it again.
Talk about the two of you as a couple. He writes about you. He says, I'm so fortunate to be married to my best friend, my very smart, book smart, school smart, life smart best friend. What was he like as a life partner?
He was a beautiful man. Elijah had an immense capacity for listening. He was a very careful listener. And when I met him early on, I just was astonished about how attentive he listened to me. And he was so compassionate that, he could feel you. And often he would say, if he felt your spirit, he'd say, I feel your spirit. And that meant he was gravitating towards you and that there was something about you that that attracted him. And he told me that earlier, that he felt my spirit. And, it was just a wonderful love story in terms of how our friendship evolved into a romance. But Elijah was supportive also. I was looking for someone who wasn't daunted by intellect, who wasn't just into looks, who, cared about the whole person. And certainly I wanted somebody I could respect and admire and love. And I found that partner in Elijah. And, he often told me that, I reminded him of his mother in terms of stature and in terms of, how I held myself. But Elijah was somebody who was influenced by a lot of women. Juanita Jackson Mitchell, who led him on that march, who inspired him to become an attorney. Lena Kay Lee, who was one of the first female attorney state legislators here in the state of Maryland, who then handpicked Elijah to then fulfill her seat. To Nancy Pelosi, who Elijah considered a mentor and whom she took under her wing and ushered him to the chairmanship. And so with that, he was somebody who wasn't intimidated by smart women and who was supportive of women.
And he writes as well, it's very clear about the love between his own father and mother and the fact that his father gave his mother every Friday, the payday, this Baby Ruth candy bar in a single flower, because that's what he could give her. Is there an Elijah equivalent?
No, I didn't get a candy bar every Friday. And then, I would get, flowers on my birthday. And, if he felt that I didn't show sufficient appreciation, he told me he wasn't going to give me any more flowers.
You got to talk about your wedding ceremony. There was not a lot of fanfare in the wedding ceremony, but he was totally in.
So it was just as casual as could be. He was driving me to the airport. I had a speaking engagement that day in Atlanta. He was like, you want to get married this evening? And I was like, sure. I'm like, okay. We'll do it around this time. And, call who you need to call. And so I get, frankly, I get on the airplane and I'm focused on my speech in Atlanta. And so I get, I do my speech, come back and I call my girlfriend, Callie. I say, can you and Gary come over around 6? And they're like, yeah, we'll be there. And lo and behold, you know, everything was in order. He had, you know, the paperwork. He secured a someone to basically hold the ceremony. And there were, you know, basically, what, 7 of us? And we got married and we went out to a restaurant right afterwards.
Very efficient, as you say. That was one of his mottos, right?
It was effective and efficient.
He was the, as you had mentioned, the son of sharecroppers as well as preachers. How did that inform his thinking or his approach to life?
I think that, you know, his value, he was a values-based leader. And so, you know, the whole notion of being raised by preachers, you know, while he didn't choose to go into the denomination of religion that they were in, which was very strict, women couldn't wear makeup, you know, all that kind of thing. You know, he, I think, took those life lessons that he learned, and it basically shaped his leadership style. In terms of the sharecropping, I think that he was just always cognizant of the underdog. You know, his folks, his family, his people, you know, were underdogs in this nation and continue to be underdogs. And so, you know, coming from very humble roots in South Carolina, where his folks were sharecroppers, where they were exploited for their labor. And where they decided to leave to find a better life in Baltimore, that was a part of his trajectory. And he respected his parents. He respected everybody who had a similar story. And I think it undergirded his story about how far he's come.
And his faith as well played a key role.
Oh, faith was everything. And that, in fact, you asked me earlier about how he kept the refrain, we're better than this. I think that it was ultimately his faith. His faith that we have better angels, that we can appeal to our better angels, and that we can live by them as long as we're willing to do better, we can be better.
One of the things that he actually brought up, I mean, it was just such an incredible moment, was after the testimony of Michael Cohen, Trump's personal attorney, 7 hours where he confessed to these misdeeds that he did for Trump and how ashamed he was, pleaded for forgiveness. And he seemed to step back. He writes about stepping back and kind of seizing that moment when he talked about when we're dancing with the angels, the question's going to be asked in 2019, what do we do to make sure we kept our democracy intact? How was he able to do that? How was he able to see the big picture and to conjure up that kind of powerful message?
That was one of his gifts. He always said, it's bigger than us. It's bigger than us. It's not about you. It's bigger than us. And he really wanted to impress upon people that we could get bogged down with all the pettiness and all the BS and all the, you know, this he said, she said. But at the end of the day, this is about how do we make life better for others? How do we make this country as great as we can? How do we make sure that we're getting the true purpose of why we're here? You know, and I think a lot of that was driven by the fact that he knew, of course, we all know that we're time bound. We're, you know, our lives are, you know, limited by the our humanity and the fact that we all expire at some point. But he just lived that daily on a daily basis with the knowledge that he was racing towards an end. And so with that, you know, he just didn't have time for the pettiness. He really wanted us to see the bigger picture.
He wrote about that. He wrote about compartmentalizing his relationships mm-hmm. and being able to separate people from their own behavior so he could see his adversaries as good people. But did that drive you nuts sometimes?
Yeah, so you're talking about in an adversarial sense, but he also did it on a personal basis too. I think that he had compartments for people. You know, he had compartments for family members. He had compartments for, you know, I think even emotions. And I think so many people live compartmentalized lives. I think one of the things that I hope that I was able to do and when I came into his life was to help you know, kind of break down some of the barriers between those compartments, because I ultimately think that it was healthier to live a holistic life. But in terms of, you know, his relationships with, you know, these, you know, Republicans and other people, you know, he was able to you know, say that, you know, that might have been their behavior or their language at one point in time. But, you know, that was then and this is now. Let's start fresh.
And he went on to say that he even couldn't sleep at night thinking of other people's pain, that he was just that his strength and his weakness was that he felt so much.
Absolutely. He was an empath. And I truly believe that it was one of his superpowers, because it was that was what undergirded and supported his ability to truly serve people, to hear what they needed and to try to make a difference in terms of providing what they needed. He, you know, people asked him for things constantly and he was constantly trying to fulfill those requests. They asked and he felt their needs deeply. So deeply that he felt their pain.
And how did he go from being a special ed kid to a Howard University scholar and a lawyer? He's got an incredible story.
Absolutely. So he went up to his teacher and he said, "I don't think I'm supposed to be in this class." And the teacher said, "Is that right?" And he's just like, "No, I just don't think I'm supposed to be in this class." And so then the teacher decided to work with him, assigned him extra, reading materials. Elijah then applied himself to everything that he had to learn. He had to go to the library after school. He got the librarians to help him. The library, by the way, was the only integrated place in Baltimore where he could go. And the librarians were white. He often mentioned that because he attended an all-Black school. And so with that, you know, he was able to test into the normal class. And so, you know, that began his belief that education is the key to his success. Education is the pathway for him to get out of poverty, to be everything that he could be in life. He was one of the first cohorts of African-American students to actually integrate Baltimore City Public Schools. And so when he went to middle school, he basically attended an integrated middle school. He went on to a high school that's considered very prestigious in Baltimore. It's called City College. And then, of course, he got into the Mecca, which is where he wanted to go because he saw other people from Baltimore go there. And he became the student body president, graduated Phi Beta Kappa. Then went on to, go to the University of Maryland Law School, where he graduated and passed the bar on the first time. And then he opened a little small law practice and was busy trying to help other Black lawyers pass the bar when he got noticed by Lena K. Lee. So, you know, I think that he challenged himself. I think he felt like he had no alternative but to try to be the best he could be. And at a very young age, he figured out education was the pathway to his success.
Was there any pressure about his name being named Elijah? He says he's not a prophet. He doesn't perform miracles, but he said he tried to live up to his name.
Yeah. So, you know, I think that it was something that defined him. His family, interestingly enough, called him Bobby.
How did that happen?
Which always made no sense to me because, you know, they have an older brother called Robert, but they don't call Robert Bobby. They called Elijah Bobby. And so with that, you know, Elijah then, of course, made a point to make sure that people called him by his name, Elijah Eugene Cummings. He always signed Elijah E. Cummings. And so, you know, I think his grandmother said that she saw something special in Elijah, and a neighbor also said the same thing. And so I think that he always wanted to live up to the greatness that they saw in him. He knew very early on, because he lived in a biblical Bible-based family, that Elijah was a prophet and a significant figure in the Bible. And I think that he wanted to live his life in the same way.
And Maya, I know this is probably tough to talk about, but he writes about this, that he his health challenges, he really left nothing to chance. In 2017, he talks about the two envelopes that he prepared before having open heart surgery. giving one to his chief of staff, Vernon, with very specific instructions, and then, you know, 2 years later, presented with those two envelopes. Can you tell us that story?
Yeah, so when Elijah went in for the heart valve surgery, there was a lot of discussion up front about what might happen. And it was a group discussion because, you know, the office had to be prepared for any eventuality. And frankly, personally, Elijah had to be prepared for any personal eventuality as well. And so I didn't realize that he had prepared several envelopes until later when Vernon was trying to give him back the second envelope. And so one envelope was if things went well, and the other envelope was to give to me in the case of his passing. And so Vernon, you know, kept asking him, should I give you back the envelope? Let me give you back the envelope. Because things went well with that surgery. Well, relatively well. It took him a while to get out of the hospital, but he eventually recovered. But Elijah told him to hold on to it. And so, you know, several years pass and, you know, we're in, you know, September, early October of 2019. Actually it was not too long before his death. And he just kept saying, I got to get out of here. I got to get out of here. I got to get out of here. And he's like, get Vernon on the phone. So I call Vernon and Elijah gets on the phone. And he says, I got to get out of here, man. I'm about to go. I'm getting out of here, man. I'm getting out of here. And Vernon said, you know, he puts me back on the phone with him and he says, Maya, does he mean he's got to get out of here as in get out of the hospital? Or does he mean something else? And I said, he means something else. And Elijah said to him, give Maya the second envelope. Hmm. And Vernon said, I'll give her the second envelope. And in that envelope were all of his instructions for his funeral. What he wanted to wear. His shoes.
I'm so, so sorry, Maya. It's so, so hard.
The songs he wanted sung. And so, you know, I did everything in my power to follow it to the letter.
Take your time, Maya. You did. It was a beautiful service, and I attended with my father. It was just beautiful. I know that he wanted you, he wanted things of you too to carry on his legacy as well as your own, to take good care of yourself, your own health, and to continue with his goals in what he had started.
Yeah. So, you know, I was facing my own health challenges in terms of having my mother 4 years before die of stage 4 breast cancer and my sister having been recently diagnosed at that time with stage 2. And to be frank with you, I had an indication that I was at risk years before because Elijah detected a lump on my chest when we first got married. And I had a biopsy done. And it turns out that it was fatty tissue. But the biopsy results also show that I had a marker. It's called LCIS. They called it stage 0 breast cancer, which is basically not breast cancer, but a marker for breast cancer, a likelihood that you would get it. So at that time, I told my mother and my sister, and we thought it curiosity, but we didn't really know what to do with the information. And that was before my mother ever got diagnosed and died and before my sister ever got diagnosed. So I knew it was coming for me. I knew it was coming for me. So Elijah and I discussed it. We scheduled an appointment with the surgeon. He went with me. And then afterwards, he was just like, Maya, you're always taking care of other people. You've got to take care of yourself. Put yourself first. Mm-hmm. And so I scheduled that surgery. And then he passed away. And I kept the surgery. I kept it despite people saying, don't do it because you're running a campaign. And I'm glad that I did. I honored his wishes. I honored my health. And frankly, if I would have waited, then we would have been in the midst of COVID and they weren't doing, optional surgeries for a long time. In terms of, the run for office, Elijah on more than one occasion told me that he thought that I would be good in Congress. Mm-hmm. He, of course, was very familiar with my background and preparation, my attitude and my passion for community. He asked me on several occasions if this was something that I would do. And I always viewed it as my job to encourage him, to focus on uplifting him, because I didn't want to talk as if he weren't there, because I wanted him to be of the frame of mind that he could, no matter what challenges he was facing, that he could make it. Whenever he would bring it up, I would deflect the conversation, frankly, because I wanted to be positive. I wanted to be upbeat. And so with that, when he passed, I consulted with close friends and family, and I made the decision to run.
So it's a remarkable journey, Maya, your journey, his journey, both of you together, the fact that you have your own legacy that you will fulfill and carry on as well as his own. I want to ask you just kind of in the final message, if you will, he writes about his mother telling him to respect the storm. Can you tell me what does that mean related to the times we're in today? What do you think he wants us to do in respecting that storm?
We have to respect the fact that there are serious dangers with this current leadership that we have in the country. And those dangers are such where we have to be extremely careful. Careful about, understanding the implications of policies, careful about, Elijah died before COVID-19 ever hit, but he would not have been surprised about what happened. And he would have been fighting hard to make sure that, additional relief was coming to people who needed it, that we had a targeted plan for the nation, that even if the, certainly the folks on the administration side weren't going to put together a comprehensive plan, that the Congress stepped into the gap. And so with that, Elijah was very much of the mind that you have to respect the storm, but you also have to prepare for after the storm. He always said, and I don't think it was in the book, but he always said, we can go through a lot of emotion, and commotion, but at the end of the day, what will we have learned? What are we going to do different? How are we going to grow as a nation because of what we've been through? And so he would have had us focused again on the big picture. How can we move towards that more perfect union? What are the next steps? How can we make sure that diversity, equity, and inclusion are centered into the life of America? That we, eliminate the threat that, intolerance and bigotry represent to so many different groups of people. And so with that, Elijah was ultimately, a great champion for democracy. I often say that when you think about the little Dutch boy, holding his finger in the dike to prevent the water from overtaking the city, Elijah, in his time, was the man with his finger in the dike trying to prevent corruption from overtaking the nation in an effort to preserve and protect our democracy for future generations.
Maya, thank you so much. I really appreciate this. It is a beautiful book. It is a wonderful read. It is called We're Better Than This, My Fight for the Future of Our Democracy. It is available at the DC Public Libraries. Reading this book will change your life. Thank you, Maya.
Thank you, Suzanne.